played Dota 2 for thousands of hours, but you've always wanted something more. A reason to fight, a deeper meaning to your battles. But to know the hidden history of Dota 2, you must go on an adventure of a lifetime. An adventure into the lore!
I know people have attempted to have a series about every single Dota 2 hero's lore before. And of course, it's a worthwhile project. After all, the Dota 2 lore is pretty amazing and should be shared with as many people as possible. Most will start with Abaddon and then get about as far as Alchemist, though. So, I'm gonna attempt to do my own episodic series on all of the Dota 2 hero's lore myself, but I'm just gonna go with whatever hero I feel like doing until I get them all done. And for our first one, we're gonna begin with Rubik. Rubik's tale is surprisingly one of gratuitous violence, along with expected magic and mysteries. Before we can talk about Rubik, though, we need to go over the lore of his father, Agnum. Agnum is, of course, the creator of Agnum Scepter, an item which, when held by a hero, will boost their magical powers beyond anything they were capable of themselves. Agnum was an artificer, a magic user who was able to endow items with magical powers. And considering he was able to create the scepter, one of the most powerful relics of all time, we can assume that he was most likely, if not the most powerful wizards, or at least artificers, in the world. The scepter is known across all walks of life and is rather infamous, seeing as how every single hero knows it by name.
Ah, scepter!
I hold this scepter in another's name.
But strangely, never says Agnum's name when they refer to it. Now, there could be a few reasons for this. Perhaps his name is taboo. Even to speak it could call him forth, a sign of both respect and fear, much like other powerful wizards in other lores. Yet all the heroes seem to see the scepter as their own. For example, Juggernaut claims that the scepter is a relic from a forgotten race. Does this mean that Agnum was the last of his kind from a people forgotten, much like Juggernaut? After all, Rubik wears a battle mask at all times, so we can assume that his father may have done the same. Does this mean that Agnum and Rubik's race were also on the Isle of Masks, but followers of magic rather than the sword? No. I don't think so, because Naga also refers to it as the Slytherin Scepter. Chen calls it the Holy Scepter. Every hero seems to think that the scepter was destined for them and is theirs, with long, rich histories about it in their own cultures. And strangely enough, it kinda is. We know from Tiny's item, the Crystal Dryad, the scepter actually changes form depending on who holds it. For when carried in a fist of stone, Agnum's scepter unleashes the spirit of the Crystal Dryad, and no foe is safe. Who is the Crystal Dryad? I don't know. But what's important here is that the scepter is so powerful, it actually warps reality to be what the user wants it to be. And it's also known throughout the world, all walks of life, and even the past is warped to include its existence. So perhaps no one says Agnum's name because the power of the scepter is so encompassing that it changes reality and history, so the holder thinks the artifact was always theirs and was destined to be held by them. Yeah, that's pretty crazy stuff, but it gives us a peek into the kind of power that Agnum is capable of conjuring. Perhaps the greatest wizard to ever live, perhaps the most powerful being in the Dota 2 lore, mostly because we don't have any information about him, except for the one relic that he left behind, his personal scepter. Well, one of two relics, I suppose, because he also left us Rubik. When purchasing the Agnum Scepter, Rubik calls it his father's masterpiece. Now, we can assume that perhaps his mind is being twisted like the other heroes, imagining that the scepter was always destined to be his from his own head, but he also has a line stating this:
"It's been so long since I held this."
Which pretty much cements that he's the real deal. Us as the player also see the scepter for what it truly is. The mind warping doesn't work on us because we play as the most powerful beings in the universe. We play as the ancients. So we can conclude that yes, the scepter really is Agnum's scepter. And yes, Rubik really is his son. And with that out of the way, we're ready to talk about the Grand Magus himself. Magical society is pretty weird. As we've learned before, the magic in the Dota 2 universe is basically knowledge. It takes a long time to create something in terms of magic, and it can take a lifetime to craft your very own spell. So the easiest way to be a more powerful wizard is to learn the secrets of others and memorize what has already been created by others over the course of their entire lives. Most, however, don't really want to share what they have been working on for their entire lives. So an easy way to make a wizard show off their secret spells is to make them use them. And what's the easiest way to make a wizard use his spells? Typically so that they can save their own lives. Violence is inherently part of wizardry in Dota. To fight a wizard is to learn from a wizard, and to learn is to grow. So what we see in the world of high magic arts is basically non-stop brawling. And no one got it worse than Rubik. Every magic user, from aspiring shaman to hardened magus, could grow in skill and reputation if they were to face off against the universe's most powerful mage and live to tell the tale. But Agnum is a mystery to us, and most likely to them all. However, his son Rubik is the next best thing. And so was Rubik's life. Assassin after assassin attempting to murder him to gain reputation or to learn of his powers. But where some may be driven to bloodlust and madness from constant attempts at their life, Rubik seemed to enjoy it. After all, it must have been all he had ever known, and he would soon start to love every attempt at his life. Originally a scholar, Rubik soon learned to become a magical duelist, delighting from the fights both organized and put forth by would-be assassins. It is there, in the heat of battle, that Rubik excelled far beyond any other wizard. Now, anyone that has been in school knows that everyone has their own way of learning, and many have their own type of intelligence. Some are visual learners, some are hands-on. The same can be said for magic users in Dota 2. To learn just one spell requires you to memorize and retain an insane amount of information. A village shaman might know one spell passed down from his father, a truly gifted wizard may know two, a hero can know three, which explains why most heroes only have three spells in an ultimate, and only entities that borderline on gods can know more than four. And this is all brought on by intelligence and memorization. Invoker is the greatest wizard of the era because he is like a Rain Man or something. He's able to store and recall an incredible amount of information he has memorized within his system of Quas Wex Exhort. But just like the real world, there are different types of intelligence. And where nearly all wizards have book smarts, Rubik, he got the street smarts. Rubik is an enigma because he's able to observe and react rather than learn and store. What's interesting is that from a neurological perspective, this is actually kind of real world stuff, just super heavily fantasized. Invoker, for example, is like a savant. He has a massive intellect, yet is oblivious to the world and people around him. While Rubik seems to have a massive case of magical ADHD, he's always looking and thinking, constantly trying to find something to keep his attention. But like Invoker, he also has his faults, his gifts of observation forcing a short attention span, meaning that he will quickly forget what incredible spell he had just mastered as he searches for something else that can interest him. Both magic users are brilliant, both are gods among men, but both are quite different in how they use their special intellects. Suffice it to say, where most wizards would be content poring over dusty books for years trying to memorize tomes, Rubik was only truly at home and learning in an action-packed combat. Growing bored of the same caliber of assassins and opponents, Rubik set off to find something more, and decided that the best way to find a challenge was to issue one, as he spread word that he wanted to kill a magus. Alright, so what's a magus? Well, magic is pretty common in this world, but a magus is a step above. They are the apex of what a wizard can become, the top tier wizardry respected and feared by all others. Not so powerful that they are shunned from society and feared, more like the shining examples of what years of scholarship and study can achieve. And Rubik said that he wanted to kill one. Now remember, magic in Dota pretty much equals violence. And intelligently, once someone had reached the magus status, they were inducted into a type of society, one that vowed to protect each other from harm. So to threaten one magus is to threaten them all. Rubik's desire to fight a magus was approved, but more so than he expected, as every single magus in the world accepted the challenge and came to destroy him. all at once. This assault would rightfully kill any wizard, but not Rubik. For a lifetime, he had been training on how to react and learn in battle, and to adapt to the magic of his enemies for himself. What his enemies had done was give Rubik the thing that he had been searching for most, a battle that would hold his attention. For a literal week, they fought, with Rubik instantly learning his enemies' spells and turning it against them, killing both the casters and letting their spells kill each other. Eventually, the Maguses began to believe that the shaky alliance which held them together was being betrayed, and they began to turn on one another. For a week, the battle raged on, Rubik throwing spells it would take a lifetime to master in mere seconds. But eventually, it was over. And all that came for him, like always, lied dead before him. He had won, but quickly he had grown bored and forgotten every single spell he had learned in the process, and he would again search for something more to keep his interest. Informing the Hidden Council that all the Magus wizards were dead, they convened with the insubstantial 11 to give Rubik the title of Grand Magus, the Magus to rule them all and surpass all others. Who are the Hidden Council and what is the insubstantial 11? No idea. But hey, perhaps they have a relation to the Hidden Ones that Templar serves? I don't know. That makes sense considering knowledge is power and these dudes are appointing titles to wizards. That would mean that they would have to have some knowledge under their command if they are people that even Rubik would respect and honor. And so it was. Rubik became the greatest Magus there ever was. Maybe. Invoker was also once a Magus, the Arsenal Magus in fact, although he seems to think himself above the title in recent years and doesn't really use it. We have no confirmation of what a Arsenal Magus is. It could be the highest title given to a Magus, or it could be that he was just recognized as being the most talented battle mage with his large arsenal of magic. Perhaps there is no hierarchy, and the word before Magus simply describes a title the council appoints to you. But suffice it to say, Rubik shows a lot of pride in his appointed title, referring to himself as the Grand Magus several times. Yet the title and recognition don't really seem to be enough. Some of his cosmetics claim that he flirted with wizard politics, perhaps attempting to join the council as they were still above him in status, but what became of that doesn't really matter. Rubik continued to lose his attention span for anything that didn't challenge him, until he finally found something that would seemingly be the ultimate challenge, something that would surely be interesting, the war of the ancients. And that about does it for the official lore of Rubik, with a little bit of speculation thrown in. The son of the most powerful wizard in the universe, who grew to love the constant threat of combat so much, he turned it into a hobby, challenging the most powerful wizards in the world and defeating them effortlessly. But who actually has faults, constantly bored and lacking attention to hold on to even the most amazing knowledge in the universe due to his ever-wandering mind? What a cool and conflicted character. But let's get on to the good shit. Let's get on to that headcanon! Alright, so as with many of the regular loregasms, it's time to tell you the non-lore. Everything I've said up to this point is a proven fact backed by the official lore, but this is the good stuff. This is the stuff in between that may or may not be. The lore I believe exists, but has no quote or official backing. This is the headcanon. So what the hell is Rubik anyway? He has some pretty distinctly human features, like very human feet and hands, but his body freaks a lot of people out. It's his strange mannerisms. He's always twitching violently and has a strange green glow to him. Because of these, there's a slew of theories about what exactly Rubik is, ranging from being a puppet of Agnum or even a wind-up doll robot. The majority of these theories imagine that Rubik is an extension of Agnum, or perhaps he was created by Agnum himself, magically created either through accident or with a mission secretly to extend his influence. While this is pretty interesting and would explain some things, I don't really buy it, mostly because the main argument is that his body isn't human. This claim is just flat out wrong though. I mean, look at those feet! Check out Undying's feet, one of the only other confirmed humans in the game. Looks just about the same to me. In fact, check out Sithil, who not only shares the same body type as Rubik, but Hey, he even shares the same sick-ass haircut. These two are so similar, in fact, one could even imagine that they were from the same race of people. I mean, those two guys are really, really similar looking. So, nah, I think Rubik actually is a real human, and he actually is the son of Agnum. And no, I don't think that he's Sithil in the future who stole Agnum's scepter and inherited his powers, although that is a dope fanfiction I just made up. But if he is just a guy, we have some splaining to do. Now, the tics are pretty easy to explain. As I stated before, I believe that Rubik has some kind of massive, exaggerated, magical ADHD, so the twitchy body makes sense. He's constantly looking for new things to keep his interest, and I don't think that really is that odd. What I really want to focus on is the green. Now, if you've been a fan of Lorgasm before, you know that I am crazy about colors. I believe that color is basically the way that the lore is organized in Dota 2, and each color represents something different, be it dire, radiant, strength, magic, everything. Everything has a specific color, and yet Rubik's colors are pretty strange for his character, that bright green. Now, we've seen this bright green before and discussed it in length in our very first episode. We typically only see evil characters in green, most if not all of them hailing from the nether reaches, the kingdom under the crust of the planet infused with an evil but magical power. Viper, Underlord, Undying, Necro, Pugna, and Rubik. Now, Rubik doesn't have many responses to other heroes, but he does have two about these specific ones. For some reason, out of all the other voice lines, these are the only ones that change his typically cheerful nature to be somewhat serious and somewhat negative. Listen to these lines for Necro and Pugna.
Your spells are but rot to me. May the arts of oblivion die with you, Pugna.
Ooh, that Pugna line is pure disdain. Quite out of character for Rubik. He doesn't have any other lines like that in the game. Rubik is fascinated by rare magics. Even when he fights heroes like Shadow Shaman or Lion, he expresses his respect for their rare magical crafts.
I am honored to have faced a shaman's skill. Sad to see such rare sorcery go to waste.
But not Pugna. No, that line is the only line where he has disdain, a negative attitude toward a character and their very rare magic, which is where my theory comes in. Perhaps the relationship to Pugna and Rubik's dislike of him can explain a lot about his father. Check out Rubik's battle vest here. He's got some liquid in there, strangely enough, which looks a hell of a lot like this strange liquid that we see bubbling up from Pugna's wards. Even a liquid that is similar to Viper. Their colors are similar, their magics are similar, and they may draw their strange power from the similar place. So here is my theory. The theory of the fate of Agnum. We know that Agnum was a powerful wizard, perhaps the most powerful in all of time, but we never know what happened to him. We do know that he was a master of them all, able to improve upon any magic that he came in contact with, but the fault of those that learn as much as they can and master all that they have learned is the thirst for knowledge never seems to end. When a new form of magic appears, despite how dangerous or corrupting, one such as Agnum would not be able to resist the allure of learning to master it. And as the nether reaches grew under the surface of the planet, a growing, malevolent, and corrupting magic grew within it, and Agnum would become obsessed with uncovering its secrets. But unbeknownst to him, this magic spawned from a new, undiscovered third ancient. Any sorcerer knew that to research a magic from an ancient meant to eventually be corrupted by it, and a wise magic user steered clear of any relics lest their mind no longer belong to them. But this new ancient was undiscovered, and Agnum slowly began to become corrupted by its powerful magics. After years of exposure, his power grew exponentially, but he turned more and more vile as he lost himself to become a thrall of the ancient below. Eventually, he would meet his end, as the nether drake he captured to study killed him, alone in his laboratory near the vents of the nether reaches themselves. But the ancients seldom let such a powerful thrall be lost to death. His soul, completely corrupted by the third ancient itself, would resurrect, reincarnating him into a boy whose spirit was completely consumed by oblivion. While any semblance of the man he was before was lost, his son lived on. A son who studied in his father's footsteps, searching for him as he lived his own life, studying his father's work and using it to further his own. Rubik would know of his father's study of the nether reaches, but thanks to his father's untimely demise, he also knew of its dangers as well. He would artifice these magic into items just like his father, but be wary of their power. It would be his mission to master the final untamed magic of this world, to succeed in the one mission his father had failed in, and perhaps to even put his father's corrupted soul to rest in the process. If Rubik could master the green magics of the Nether, perhaps one day he could leave his own mark on this world. Perhaps he could even make a scepter of his own. Or, you know, not. That's my personal headcanon for why Rubik seemingly uses the Nether magics and why he seems to only hate out of every hero in the game Pugna. Now, was any of that based in fact? not really. But that's what makes this game so much fun. Sometimes you get enough to make your own stories. And sometimes your heart gets stolen by the lore! Thanks everybody for watching this episode on Rubik for Loregasm. It is a lot of fun and I can't wait to get through every single hero headcanon included. If you've been enjoying this series or you want to be part of it, check out the Patreon where I post all the scripts and write these episodes along with you guys. Shout out to everybody that works on the project. Mary Mind, of course, made some fantastic custom artwork. You can look at that here, although we're always looking for artists to help us out as well. More art equals more cool videos. Shout out to Casimir Jones and, of course, David, the graphics and editor guys, and we hope to do another hero soon. Which hero do you want to see next? Well, that's pretty easy. Just write a comment in the video. Whichever hero gets the most comments, I will do next. Thanks everybody for watching and hope to see you again for more lore!